Happy Wednesday, everyone. Welcome to the Wolff Den. I'm Matt Wolff, founder and CEO of Ticket Time Machine. Today we have a very special guest, TJ Nelligan. TJ, welcome to the show.
Matt, great to be here. It's a pleasure.
Yeah, so we're going to hit on a lot of stuff today, but tell everybody a little bit about yourself and a little bit about Live Like Sean, which is a new book that you have published, and we'll go from there.
Terrific. Well, I spent 25 years in college sports marketing and media. The last 15 running Nelligan Sports Marketing, which I founded. We did that for 15 years, represented a lot of conferences, colleges, universities, had almost 400 employees in 40 different offices around the country. Had a great time, went to 25 Final Fours in a row. So that was a pretty good streak.
That's awesome.
And then one of our competitors came to us and wanted to buy us. So we reluctantly sold, a deal that we couldn't pass up. But while I had the company, Sean, who's my son, who's the book that I wrote, worked at Nelligan Sports Marketing. He worked at a restaurant we had with his buddy Bobby from Special Olympics. And it really was an amazing time to watch the way that they interacted and all the lessons that I learned from him, you know, from his teen years until he passed away in June of 19 on Father's Day. You know, the last 10 years, I saw all the things in the way he lived. Like, he was grateful. He couldn't spell grateful. But yet, there he was, living every day, happy as could be. And I think the hardest thing for parents that have special needs children is the very beginning, your hopes and dreams are dashed, not necessarily your child's. You know, Sean, once he became his teen, the early years are very difficult because you're going to doctors and physical therapists and speech therapists. They're on medications. You know, the development is obviously takes a lot longer than a, quote, normal child. But once he got into his teen years, he developed this amazing personality and he walked around. I used to call him the mayor, and he got involved with Special Olympics. He got very good at basketball, the camaraderie and team aspect of it, and just all the friends that he made in Special Olympics was amazing.
Well, I can tell you that a lot of people have trouble spelling grateful because we never know if it's A-T-E or E-A-T. I just want to say hi to my friend Corey right here. Corey is my concert buddy. Corey's special needs. He's the happiest person I know, and he's always supportive of me and jumps on the show. So,
hey, Corey, thanks for being on, buddy.
Yeah, hopefully we'll have some good material. Well, let's start from the beginning. Tell us a little bit about Sean and, you know, how it evolved to, obviously, you know, why you wrote the book, but just tell me a little bit about Sean and what it was like, you know, living with him as opposed to living like him.
Well, you know, living with him, the first 10 years, as I said, we went to the top neurologist for children in the country, and all he did was give us a laundry list of all the things he would never accomplish, all the things he would never do. He's never going to have a job. He's never going to go to college. He's never going to graduate high school. And as he gets older, it will be more pronounced and it'll be harder on the parents and on Sean. So that was a bad day. And then, as I said, as he grew into his own personality and started playing sports, I started to watch that he couldn't speak in front of 1,000 people. But if he was with you, Matt, he would find out what teams do you like and talk about sports or movies or music. And he was present in the moment with that person. Unlike someone like me, type A personality at a reception, and I'm talking to Matt here, and all of a sudden I say, oh, there's a big shadow over Matt's shoulder. I got to go talk to him because I'm trying to get a deal done with him. Yeah. So I think it's very hard for, you know, type A personalities who are so driven and have such high goals to not only live in that moment, but to be grateful for where you are. Because you set a goal, and then when we get there, we move the goalposts. We make the goals higher, and now it's another goal to hit. So the first 10 years I was in college sports and looking back, I have hardly any pictures to have memories of all those Final Fours and all the corporate people I met and all my colleagues that I worked with. And then when Sean got into his teen years and I saw how he was always present with people and accepting of people who were different than him, I realized that it's not a destination. We're not going to be happy when we get X number of employees or we get to the next goal or we have more colleges and universities we're representing. It's a journey. And you have to get out of bed every day and say, I'm going to do everything I can today. And I'm going to be grateful for that. And I'm going to be present with the people I'm with. And yeah, we still have goals and we still want to achieve those goals, but doing it in a different way makes it so much more fun. And that's the hardest thing for me anyway, was to realize that life is a journey, not a destination. And Sean taught me that.
Well, what did Sean have? I don't know if you mentioned that.
Well, he, you know, when he was born, we thought we took home a perfectly healthy baby boy. I think it's easier in some ways when they just give you a diagnosis. You know, you have a child with Down syndrome or with whatever the diagnosis is. His just unraveled over the first 3 to 4 months and then over the next year. And then when we went to the neurologist when he was about 2 years old, he basically said he has intellectual disabilities. You know, he'll have some physical disabilities. His muscles aren't as strong. We thought maybe he had cerebral palsy. He ended up not having that. He was just very weak. And then as he got stronger and bigger, you know, everything was fine. Now, you know, I talk about in the book that my dreams were shattered for my first child, not Sean's. He didn't know what he couldn't do. He only knew what he could do and what he could achieve. And that's what he focused on. And once you as a parent see that and realize, let's look at the world through the eyes of our special needs child, not through our eyes, it's a much better place. It's a much happier world. And it's amazing.
I agree. Do you have other children?
I have two daughters, Maura and Megan, both just graduated college, one from Syracuse, one from Seton Hall. And, you know, they always said, and they're younger than Sean, but as they got older, intellectually, they would bypass him. And they were like having, you know, his mother, Maggie, and then he had Maura and Megan. It was like he had three mothers protecting him. And they always said, we thought we had to protect him, Dad. We thought we had to teach him about the world. And it turns out the story ends that Sean taught us more about life than we could have ever taught him.
Yeah. Was there any thought or concern about, you know, your daughters having the issues that Sean has, or is it not hereditary? Is it?
No, the bottom line is we don't know how it happened, or, you know, it just happened in utero, and it is what it is. And I always said, you can't go back. And I see a lot of parents that are angry and sad, and they go down a road of, you know, despair. And I looked at that I can't change it. You got to play the cards you're dealt and just move on. And, you know, his mom, Maggie, and his sisters, Maura and Megan, always said that, you know, God gave us Sean, and he was the perfect child for us, and we were the perfect parents for him. And you don't realize that at first. At first, you have the why me's and feel sorry for yourself. And later you say, wow, this young man taught us so much and gave us so much joy in our life.
Well, you know, you got to get lucky. And I don't have kids. My brother, I have a twin brother who has four of them. And whether it's someone who's a special needs or it's someone who's ADHD or whatever it is, you just really got to get lucky to be able to be the right fit. Because there's a lot of people who aren't the right fit. And
right.
It could be explosive and, you know, all types of horror stories. So special needs are not, you know, there's a obviously a special bond between parents, and, you know, you have to be able to handle whatever they're going through. And I assume, again, I don't have parent kids, but, you know, with all the phases that they have, there's just so many like landmines that could happen. And how do you navigate through that? It's good. You know, I think the people who have the special needs are even, you know, I look at you know, someone like you, and I'm excited to read the book, but to be able to not have, some people have to focus everything on the kid, right? But some people are able to do their own thing and also be as good a parent as they could to the people with special needs. So, you know, I think, you know, what you said is exactly it. Did you have, you know, tell me, when did you think about writing this book? Was Sean alive? Did you talk about it with him?
No, I never thought I would write a book, ironically. And, you know, I always say it's not even my book, it's Sean's book. I'm just the messenger. You know, I was involved in 25 years at Special Olympics, which I never would have chosen, but it chose me through Sean. So as I sat down to write his eulogy, I came up with all these funny stories of things that he said to famous people and not famous people. And because it came from a place of kindness and authenticity, it's not something you and I would say, Matt.
No, no.
The recipient of that question or that conversation knew it was coming from a place of curiosity, and the intent was genuine and kind. So he would say things all the time. So I wrote all those stories down and I came up with the phrase, live like Sean. And I told all these stories to almost 1,000 people that were at his memorial. And the Special Olympics basketball team he plays on was there. They all had their uniforms on, the Storm. The Special Olympics color guard was there. The bagpipers were there. And it was a celebration of his life. And that was his sister's idea because they said, Sean went to, I think, one funeral in his life, one home, and he hated it. Like, he did not want to be there. And his sister says, we can't do that. We have to have a celebration of Sean's life and make it happy because he was always happy and he was amazing. So I gave this talk, and then his mom spoke and his sisters more and Megan spoke. And as we got done and mingling with the crowd, my friend Steve Adubato, who's on TV in New Jersey, came up to me and he's written 4 books. And he said, that was amazing. And he said, and that, live like Sean, what you just said is the outline for your book. Do you know how many people you're going to help through Sean's messages and through Sean's lessons that he taught all of us? And I told him, basically, you're out of your mind. How am I going to write a book? Did you see my English SAT scores? I mean, come on.
Funny, actually, my English SAT scores were off the charts. Oh, no. My English SAT scores were terrible. My math ones were off the charts.
Right. That was me, too.
Yeah. But it's well, that, you know, so that's where the inspiration for the book came. We've unfortunately been to a couple of funerals and, you know, services where it's, you know, we have a celebration of life after. And I think that's just, I'd love to have that. I hope it's, you know, a long, long time. But I think it's just very important to do, to have the celebration of life, because look, we're all going to grieve, and you're still grieving, and I lost my father in 05. I'm still grieving, but we have to celebrate the person and then understand that, you know, the lessons that you're saying and live like Sean. I mean, I have so many moments where it's like life is short, and every time you get one, you have to keep reminding yourself. So I think this is a great story to tell there. We had a Zoom funeral, obviously, with COVID going on. Like, what would have happened if that was the scenario? Do you ever think about that?
No, but I think about Sean wouldn't know what to do because he gave everybody giant bear hugs for like a minute or two. And everybody couldn't wait to get a Sean bear hug. And obviously, because I was in sports marketing, we went to tons, thousands of college football games, college basketball, the Yankees, the Giants, and never left the game early. That's why being present in the moment. You know, we went to a Yankee game, and it was Derek Jeter's last game, and they're winning by 3 going into the top of the ninth. So I'm like, all right, buddy, let's get out of here, beat the traffic. He's like, no way. And we would have missed Jeter's walk-off in the bottom of the ninth in his last game at Yankee Stadium for a guy that had thousands of iconic moments. That's probably the most amazing one. And if it wasn't for Sean being present at the moment, we would have missed that.
Yeah. So, I mean, timing is, it's unbelievable the way timing is in life. I took a trip up to New Jersey for my nephew's bar mitzvah, and on my way down, I just had dinner and a drink with my friend, and I caught COVID, you know, days. It could have been a day or gone after, who knows, it wouldn't have happened. And I do, you know, I mentioned the Zoom funeral because if it did happen later, it's very possible that, you know, maybe someone didn't see it or he didn't have that idea, you know, maybe he did, maybe he wouldn't, you just never know. And so it's real, you know, you got to really be thankful about, you know, the time, and it could be the right place at the right time, the right place at the wrong time, the wrong place at the right time, you know, who knows?
Yeah. I mean, the point was he wouldn't know what to do. No sporting events, and I can't hug anybody.
Yeah.
That would be a nightmare for Sean.
What were his favorite teams?
Oh, he loved the Yankees. He loved Rutgers football, Seton Hall basketball, because we play with Kevin Willard, the coach, play golf with him all the time. But Sean went to everything. Sean sat in the suites at Louisville games, Seton Hall games, the Big East tournament with athletic directors. Everybody knew Sean. You know, we made Greg Schiano was the honorary coach of Special Olympics New Jersey when I was involved. And their first bowl game, he comes down the escalator with the whole team before the game, and he sees Sean. He runs over and goes, give me my good luck hug, buddy. And then when they won their first bowl game, Greg said, I can't give every special athlete a ring, but I have one for Sean. So he had the Rutgers bowl game win, and it says Nelligan on the side. So that's the impact he even had on coaches when they would meet him, because he would ask them questions that none of us would ask. You know, if you don't recruit a better quarterback coach, you're going to get fired. You'd be like, oh boy, who would say that? The biggest donor doesn't say that to the coach. And he just would blurt out anything that came to his mind, but the recipient always responded. They wouldn't have responded to me.
Do you think that sometimes they just don't know what they're missing, and that's maybe why there's happiness, you know, with the ones who are just always happy all the time? Or how does that even happen?
No, I think that a lot of people would look at children with Down syndrome or with intellectual disabilities and think, you know, what do they have to be happy or grateful about? And yet their attitude is more positive, and those things are actually assets, you know? They have more assets than we have, and they just look at the world differently. You know, they're just kinder, they're nicer, they're genuine, they're authentic. You know, I had so many stories about Sean that are hilarious. You know, we were at the Super Bowl in Phoenix when the Giants were playing the undefeated Patriots. And we're in the lobby of the hotel, and he's got his number 10 blue Eli Manning jersey on. And there's no one in the lobby because, of course, my business partner and his son and Sean and I have to get on the first bus and be there 3 hours before the game, right? That was our timing. We'd be the first people in there watching them warm up. So in walks Peyton Manning in a suit and tie from wherever he might have been. And he sees my business partner's son has a Tom Brady jersey on and Sean has Eli Manning. So he comes walking, makes a beeline directly to us. And he points at Josh with the Brady jersey and says, I don't like that one, but I know that guy. And Sean looks at him in the loudest voice you could ever. He has a booming voice and says, you're Eli's brother. And Peyton Manning started laughing so hard. And I said, has anyone ever said that to you? And he's like, no.
That reminds me of Seinfeld, one of my favorite shows. And Kramer goes, he says, I didn't know. Oh, Elaine goes, I didn't know that Cheryl Miller's little brother played basketball. So one of those. Right. I love what Peyton.
And that's what's funny is that, you know, and I talked to him because the Mannings were always involved in Special Olympics in New Orleans and everywhere else. And so about 2 years later, Sean and I are walking in Hoboken, New Jersey, where I live, right on the river overlooking New York City. And Eli lived two buildings away from me. So on a Thursday afternoon, we're walking along, and here comes 100 yards away in front of us, I go, Sean, that's Eli Manning. And he said, nah, too small, Dad. He's too small. And he's got a little tiny white dog. And as he gets closer and closer, Sean says, Dad, that's Eli Manning. So we go up, we chat with Eli, thank him, tell him, you know, Sean's your big fan. He's always wearing your jersey. And I tell him the Peyton Manning story. And he goes, Sean, that was you? You're my man. And he hugs him. He goes, my brother told me that. Nobody talks to him like that. I love you.
Oh, that was great.
And then they turn and Sean goes, Eli, we're playing the Eagles that weekend. I think we lost five times in a row to him. So with a really sad face, he looks at Eli. He says, Eli, I hate the Eagles. Please beat them. And Eli looks back, feeling the compassion of where it's coming from. And Eli now has a sad face. And he says, I hate them too. I'll try, Sean.
Well, I married a Philly girl. She's a big Eagles fan. Howie Roseman, the GM, went to high school together and University of Florida together. I root for the Giants, but I also root for the Eagles. I know I'm not like those aren't my teams. I just root for them for different reasons. I think I told you maybe when we talked that my brother lived on 14th and Washington,
right,
in the Chinese restaurant above a Chinese restaurant. I loved the times in Hoboken. What's been the reception? I assume it's got to be all positive, but tell me, you know, some of the real motivating things that have come from you writing the book, people that might have reached out. Have you spoken in front of a lot of people? Just tell me, you know, maybe some of the stories that stick out about that.
Well, the amazing thing is when I said, you know what, I'll write the book, maybe it'll be therapeutic. And I really wrote it because 20 or 30 years from now, I don't want to forget all these stories. I want to forget all the funny little anecdotes that I probably will in 10 or 20 or 30 years. So I figured, all right, I'll write the book. We'll probably, you know, print 200 copies. We'll give them out to family and friends, the Special Olympics teammates, coaches, you know, and we'll be done with it. And then as I kept going, next thing I know, it kind of took on a life of its own. And, you know, we went on sale and for Amazon on January 19th. And by the 22nd, it was number two in new releases on the Kindle and 20th, I think, for books in our category, which is I had no idea that was going to happen. And I've done about three or four TV shows. You know, people are calling now like crazy because of the publicity we've been getting. And it's just been great because I think that this book is Sean's book, as I said, but it's also his legacy. And the reviews on Amazon from people I don't even know who they are, or, you know, we have a Facebook, TJ Nelligan Facebook and LinkedIn, and we put all these podcasts on there and radio shows and TV shows. And the response from the people that have read the book has been overwhelming. Like, I wrote it, I cried more than I laughed. I knew Sean was like that. But for other people, and not just special needs families, they said, I felt all the emotions that you felt. There are people that wrote reviews, I've never met them in my life, that say, I was crying reading this part and laughing reading this part. And so it, you know, I always said inspiration can come from the most unlikely places. Who thought he would inspire really thousands and thousands of people? For all the things that we did for Special Olympics New Jersey with Mark Edenson, who was the president at the time, and then hosting the Special Olympics USA games and getting a team of people to go out to corporate America and get 62 companies to give us $20 million. So if not for Sean and all the other Special Olympics athletes, the people that went to the meetings, they wouldn't have been inspired to go do that. So the person doesn't have to be in the room to be the inspiration for what the outcome is.
Right.
And it's just amazing. And so it was really hard at times, and it's still hard talking about it sometimes, but I feel like Sean is alive in me. You know, I said part of me died with Sean that day, but part of him will always be inside me. And I just feel like he's going to help so many people through his message and his lessons and the way he lived, you know. And I even had golf balls printed up. Still waiting for him. I'm still waiting for him to get me a hole in one.
Oh, wow.
Every time I tee up on a par three, I look at Live Like Sean. I'm going, come on, buddy, where are you? Let's go, hole in one.
You got to do one where they're giving away a Toyota.
Right.
Get all crazy about it. Did he pass suddenly, or you kind of knew?
No, he passed away on Father's Day. He was with me alone at the beach house. And, you know, he had a seizure disorder, but he hadn't had a seizure in 18 years or more, probably more. So it was sudden, it was shocking. And, you know, I don't think you ever get over it. And I've met so many parents who were business colleagues or people that were acquaintances, and some that I was good friends with who I knew lost a child. But I would say 20 people have reached out to me who have lost a child in all different ways. And I don't think any of them, you know, you learn how to live with it, but I don't think you ever get over it. You just build the bridge over your heart and you try to do something that's meaningful. And I think that writing Sean's book to help other people hopefully will be meaningful enough to affect them and affect change.
Yeah. And, you know, that's one of the questions I was going to ask you. I'm part of a SAME Here, which is a global mental health movement. You know, what did you do to with the family? How did you kind of, did you reach out? Did you go to groups like in AA, you know, where it's a bunch of people with the same,
I have this guy in New Jersey, Joe, who's my therapist, who is awesome. I think everybody should have one, by the way. I wish I had him when I started my company. I think, you know, it's like having a life coach. And what's ironic is we hire sales, you know, pros to teach our people how to sell. We send people to training and development for all different aspects of a corporation, but we don't send ourselves to have somebody that you can be honest with and talk to about the hardest things in your life, which this was. And he's the one I plagiarized him. He's the one that told me part of you died with Sean, but part of him will always be inside you. And you're going to help so many people with this amazing book about Sean's life lessons.
Yeah. So,
you know, I always say that, you know, people don't want to say that, but to me, I wish I'd met him 25 years ago. I probably would be a better human and maybe more successful.
Well, I don't know about more successful, but it sounds like you're doing pretty good here. The you know, in same here, Eric Hussey, who's the founder of it. One of the things they talk about is if you're sick, you go to the doctor. If you hurt your arm, like if you have problems up here, like people aren't going generally to just go, you know, get themselves taken care of. And like anything else, it's going to manifest. So, you know, if you're grieving and you don't grieve, and we've all, I mean, everyone has lost something,
right?
You know, you can't compare any of it, but if you just don't express it or allow yourself that moment, then it's just going to manifest and manifest. And, you know, when my dad died, I said, you know, I think I did something maybe the weekend after that was just a lot of fun for me, because that's just what I do. I like, you know, I'll never forget my dad. I cry all the time when I think about him. They're happy tears. But, you know, you just life is going to move on with or without you. And so that's probably like some of the best advice I can give someone who's grieving. Is like, look, do what you have to do. If you have to pause your life for 3 months or 6 months, then do that. But life is going to move on whether you want it to or not. So you have to move on with it. And that's, you know, I think people need to understand that more. And you know, people need to talk. If you need help, talk to someone. Whether it's reaching, you can reach out to me. There's plenty of people in your circle who want to talk to you. Sometimes I've had a therapist. Sometimes talking to someone who you've never met and, right. and don't have anything, it's a lot easier to talk about what you want to talk about.
Well, that's absolutely true. And there's a stigma, right, around it that people think, oh, I don't want anybody to know I'm going to a therapist. I tell everybody because I want them to say, well, if he can go, maybe it'll make them comfortable enough to go. I don't know.
Yeah.
But it's the best thing I ever did. And everybody should do that.
Yeah, we might have to, it'd be good to have you get involved and at least talk a little bit about the same here, because just having the conversation is going to move it forward. And talking about, like, live like Sean, talking about dealing with special needs. And that's a taboo subject too, isn't it? I mean, not everybody likes to talk about it. They're uncomfortable with it. They don't want to ask the wrong questions or say the wrong things. So I think having this conversation in the book is going to help that as well.
Yeah, there's no question about that. And everybody should do it. And I mentioned it in my book also. Like, do it. Yes, I have a therapist and I'm proud of it. And you should go do that too. And it changes your life for the better. But, you know, the funny thing is, when you think about it, 100% of the people we know are going to die. Right? We just don't know when. I wish they'd tell me what day it was. We
don't know. I don't know.
And nobody's going to tell you. And no, nobody should ever lose a child because it's not the natural circle of life. But at the end of the day, it's not what happens to you in life. It's how you deal with it. And that's the key. Some people go down a road and they never recover. And it's the same thing with having a special needs child. You know, some people hide them. They don't want to go out. They're embarrassed if they're loud in a restaurant or embarrass them. Sean went everywhere with his mom and his sisters and me. And if anybody had a problem with that, that was their problem. Sean's still coming. He went to every game. He met presidents of universities. And, you know, sometimes he'd do things that maybe, you know, I wouldn't do or you wouldn't do. But who cares? That's his authentic, genuine self. And everybody loved him for it.
Who was his most favorite person that he ever met? Do you know?
Oh, who's his favorite person? I mean, funny thing was he treated everybody the same. So, I mean, he loved Eli Manning just because that was his team. He met Derek Jeter. He's met so many famous athletes. But coming into work, when he worked at Nelligan Sports and he worked in accounts receivable, the first day he came to work, his mom dropped him off. I see him and his buddy Bobby. We get him to work doing accounts receivable. They put all the bills in, put them through the postage and mail them. And at the end of the day, Sean and I are leaving to go to Hoboken for the weekend. And he says, all right, see you later, Bruno, to the security guy at the front desk. I felt about 2 inches tall. And he goes, say hi to your grandkids for me. And I'm looking at him. I go, hi, Bruno, I'm TJ Nelligan. He goes, oh, yeah, I know who you are. You're on the 7th floor. And I'm walking out. I felt 2 inches big. I've walked by this man for 10 years. And I'd say, oh, good morning. I didn't know his name. I walked by him for 10 years. Sean walked by him, stopped for 3 minutes, knew his name and knew he had 2 granddaughters. And so he met everybody. He would talk to everybody. And if they didn't, you know, want to engage, he sensed it and he moved on to the next person.
Yeah, that's great. You see that in the movies a little bit. And then there's some celebrities. You saw that a little bit with Michael Jordan. If you watched the Last Dance, they showed a little bit about that. I'm assuming this is one of your friends. You know Heather?
Hi, Heather. How are you?
Hi, Heather. Yeah. Thanks for watching. Any questions you guys have for TJ, put them in the chat. This is my boy, Emmanuel. Thanks for hosting these dialogues. They're important to know. It's universal, of course. It's, you know, it's just having the conversation. That's all. Sometimes that's just the what you need is just to start the conversation.
Right.
And you find that once you talk about it, it becomes very easy to talk about. I assume, you know, like the first time you probably talked about what was going on, you were probably very nervous and anxious. And now you've done it. And now it's like you probably have some sense of pride, of course, but it becomes easier for you, right?
Well, you know, an Irish guy with a microphone could go off for an hour. I might not make any sense, but I could talk and fill the time. But no, I mean, you know, everybody always says that speaking in public is makes them the most nervous. And when we hosted the Special Olympics USA Games, there was 20,000 people in the Prudential Center, and I gave a welcoming address, and everybody said, "Aren't you nervous?" I said, "I would be really nervous if I was speaking in front of 500 heart surgeons about heart surgery, and I know nothing about it. Yeah. I'm talking about my life. You know, I'm talking about Special Olympics and what we're going to achieve and what we're trying to do, and talking about Sean and the lessons he taught us. So it's very simple to talk about it, because if you believe in it and you have a passion for it, it's easy to talk about.
We got a family member.
That's my sister, Eileen.
Eileen, thanks for joining us here. Yeah, TJ is doing a great job. I love what you're doing. What's the next plan for this book? Are you wanting to go and maybe do a little speaking tour? Are you going to write another book with some more stories? You know, what do you hope to achieve, you know, on the success of this? And then also personally for you.
Well, the first thing I learned is that it's a journey. So today I'm talking to Matt. I don't know. I have one tonight with Special Olympics Indiana with 150 people as their speaker at their dinner through Zoom. I'll be standing in the same spot. The only good thing about COVID is I've done 20 of these and I didn't have to leave my office here in Florida. That's 70 and sunny. But I think, you know, the plan is, yes, I'm looking forward to marketing this because it really just came out. Official date was January 19th. We're going to do this book tour virtually for now until we can get in bookstores. We're working with all the Special Olympics programs around the country, all the states, to get them involved. And we've had amazing interest already. And then, you know, we'll see where we go from there. Maybe the movie will come out.
Yeah, I actually had that in my mind because you see – I mean, there's been some movies or shows like this, and I think it would be great. I think didn't they come out with a movie for Tuesdays with Maury and all and stuff like that? It's who would play you or who would play Sean?
Brad Pitt, I'm sure, would be my guy. Or maybe he's too old now. I don't know. Sean would be a tough one to get because he's such a unique character.
Yeah.
But maybe Tuesdays with Maury. You mentioned Tuesdays with Maury. Ironically, Mitch Albom endorsed my book, and I'm on his radio show this Thursday. And I've read all his books, and just through a mutual friend, he said, sure, because he lost a daughter also that he adopted. So we emailed back and forth for a while, and then he said, I'd be happy to. And what's amazing is, you know, it's on the back of the book, and this is how I know how hard it is to write a book now. It's really hard. Thank God I had, you know, Teresa DiGeronimo as my co-writer. I would just write and write and write, send it to her. She'd send it back, and I'd say, wow, am I smart. Thanks for the big words.
Sounds great.
But this is what Mitch Albom writes, and it shows you why he's sold, you know, tens of millions of books, because he captured the book in one sentence. He says, a book for anyone who has ever been fiercely inspired by a child, which should be everyone. Mitch Albom, New York Times bestselling author. And I got Harlan Coben, which is shocking to me.
Yeah. And so, you know, these types of books are great because they are for everyone. You don't need to be a special needs. It's just more about, as Paul says, about life and perspective and just, you know, I love those type of stories. I'm actually going to start to read more. And these are the types of stuff that I love to read because it's like, even I'll watch movies. There's like, you know, it's entertainment, right? But there's stories to tell in all of that, in the TV shows. And, you know, it's just stuff that people need to, they know about. Like, I'm not sure that there's stuff in the book that people have never heard of, but they don't realize that they should be doing it. And they don't, you know, to see someone else doing it, especially in the type of situation with Sean is, it's really, you know, it's heartwarming. You know, when you get to the, you know, you start touching people's hearts, I think, you know, it's really going to be, you know, explode. And then the more people do it, and then someone's saying, oh man, I read this book. I think that's the type of book that you have here.
Well, an interesting quote, Maya Angelou always said, you might not remember what they said to you, but you'll remember how they made you feel. And I think that's Sean, that everybody won't remember the conversations they had with him, but they'll always remember the love, the unconditional love that he had for all his cousins, all his friends, his whole family, his sisters, you know, especially his mother. It was amazing.
Well, you have another family member. You got Sheila chiming in too, talking.
That's Sean. That's my sister, and that's Sean's godmother.
So you got two sisters joining in, and it's a family affair here. My brother, Evan, that's my twin. He's the one who lived in Hoboken.
Oh, hey, Evan, how are you?
In Franklin Lake. Hey. He's got four kids of his own.
Great.
Family is everything to us, so it's great to see the type of family you have. I don't know who this is, but they ordered the book and loving the stories that you're telling. So great. That's what we hope to see. You know, you think about the stuff that we do, and you know, I don't know who's going to watch this, but if it could touch one person, right? If it inspires one person to buy the book, or if it touches one person's life to want to go out and you know, treat someone else or do good for others, it's just a really good feeling. And to think about how many people that you're going to touch and you're never even going to know about. I always talk about immeasurable data. You're never going to know that you've changed these people's lives.
Right.
Well, you are. And, you know, not everyone likes to get on camera or put a review in there. And, you know, I think that's one the special thing is it's not really about the number of people that you do. It's just about the fact that it's possible.
And it's shocking that this book was number two in new releases, and that on LinkedIn, as we keep posting all the podcasts and TV interviews and other things on LinkedIn, I'm in shock. Some of them have 5,000, 6,000, 7,000 views that people watched. And then they put comments underneath. I bought the book. A lot of people have a picture of them with the book. And it is really like Paul Garbus was on here a minute ago. I saw his quote. Paul, he grew up around the corner from me in Montville, New Jersey. And it is. He's right. The book, maybe the primary audience is people with a special needs child or siblings or cousins or whoever. But it's really life lessons for anyone. It's you know, there's hundreds of thousands of books on all these topics on Amazon. But this tells the story about someone who inspired us, who others would say, why would you be inspired by this special needs kid? And then you realize, well, here's the million reasons why.
I don't know how you get inspired by some of these people. That's right. That's what I would say. My brother says the TED Talk called Lollipop Moments. Have you seen it?
I haven't seen that, but that's next on our list. I saw a couple of TED Talks that I watched that that Sean's mom, Maggie, sent to me about other people that wrote books about grieving about their husband or their father or their mother. And I saw a couple of them that were really outstanding. So I'm always looking on the TED Talks, thinking about maybe we should do one of those.
I was just going to ask, is that on the roadmap? Are you going to do a TED Talk of your own? It's
if Rachel, who you met, gets it done, then we will. Rachel, let's go.
I think Rachel's doing a great job so far, so we're excited to see where this
goes. Doing great.
Yeah. So Sean, did he actually play in the Special Olympics?
Yeah, he was in Special Olympics for almost 20 years, maybe more. And played soccer, played bocce, played basketball. He liked basketball the best. And, you know, he wouldn't play defense. Like all the Nelligans, an assist is considered a turnover. You just shoot, and you don't play defense to wear yourself out. And, in fact, a little shorter Special Olympics athlete dribbled by him. He moved out of the way and let the athlete make the layup. And later I said, Sean, block that kid's shot. He's smaller than you. And he goes, Dad, that's not nice.
That's a great, I love watching. I follow Rex Chapman on Twitter. He's a great follow if you're not following, because he, I mean, he does a lot of stuff that's funny, but he shares some real heartwarming stories. And every time you see a story where the kid with special needs is on the football team and he's running for a touchdown and you know, they let the special needs kid score a basket in basketball. Do you remember the guy's name who was like the manager who was a special needs and he came in and hit like 8 3-pointers or something like that?
That was on CBS News. That was an amazing story. And in fact, that young man, after he got on CBS This Morning and all these shows, was actually there with a sponsor at the Final Four that year. And I met him and got my picture with him and I was talking to him.
Oh, that's awesome.
That was a great story. But, Sean's story, the movie about Sean, is like a Rudy for the special needs athletes. And after Sean passed away, you remember Peter Butter Falcon came out?
Yeah.
So everybody told me I should watch that, and I couldn't. I just couldn't watch that. I had no idea what it's about. It won like Academy Awards and other awards, and I'm like, I'm not watching that. Well, about 2 weeks ago, I'm sitting there flipping through Netflix, and I see it. So I said, okay, maybe it's time. And I watched it, and it's a great movie, great story. And the young man with Down syndrome was a tremendous actor. But at the end, I said, you know what? I think we could make a better movie about Live Like Sean. And it would be just a great, great story.
Thanks, Destin. Yeah, I think it would be a great story. You ever see the movie with Johnny Knoxville about the special needs?
Yes. Yeah, that was actually, I think, endorsed by Special Olympics. Yeah.
So it's a pretty funny movie. And they had.
Yeah, he pretends to be a Special Olympics athlete and then realizes he becomes friends with all of them. And
yeah, he was trying to swindle them. Well, listen, let's talk a little bit about the Special Olympics, because I think a lot of people don't really know too much about it. And I'm one of those. Are there levels of Special Olympics? Because I remember seeing the big, opening events overseas. Is there a World Olympics and then a U.S. Olympics and then a Florida Olympics? Or is it just like one big thing and this is where they're at?
Well, to break it down, there are basically a state program in every state. And Florida and California have a Northern California, Southern California, Northern Florida, Southern Florida. So Special Olympics New Jersey has 24,000 athletes that participate, maybe more now, in 16 to 20 different sports, both winter sports and summer sports. And then every year they have a state winter games with skiing and ice skating and all that. And then they have in the summer at College of New Jersey, there's 4,000 athletes that participate, and they participate in all the different sports at different skill levels. So some of the Special Olympics basketball teams could beat a high school team in New Jersey. They're phenomenal athletes. And Sean's team would be in the middle of that pack, but you play against your level of competition and you're just trying to do your personal best and maximize your potential. And then every 4 years, we hosted the Special Olympics USA Games in 2014 in New Jersey, and we had 4,000 athletes, 80,000 spectators, had four college campuses and, other small private schools hosting 16 different sports. And we raised over $20 million. And it was the highest profile event at the time for these USA games. And then Special Olympics International, which was founded by Eunice Kennedy Shriver over 50 years ago, is based in Washington, D.C. Tim Shriver's chairman of the board. And they run world games and oversee all this, international competition as well. So they'll run the world games in all different countries, a winter games and a summer games.
There's a 22 Special Olympics Florida.
That's going to be hosted at Disney, the Wide World of Disney. They'll have in 2022, and that will end up being, we started the trend of raising a ton of money, a lot of big, Fortune 100 companies. Seattle did a good job out there in 18, and then in 22, Disney's hosting it in Orlando, and it's going to be massive. So it keeps on growing every 4 years, which is great. And what it does is, it gives everybody the opportunity, what I call outside the bubble. All of us inside the Special Olympics bubble know all about it. But this high profile event that'll be on television, ESPN's a partner with them, and Disney is going to, be able to tell the message of Special Olympics and how life changing it is for families. So, families out there should get involved. I didn't know anything about it until I got involved with Sean. And it truly is a life changing thing. And we want to change the perception people have of special needs athletes or special needs people. We want to change the perceptions one at a time, and it takes time, But it's such a different world today than when I was in high school.
Yeah. So what, you know, why is that? Is it just the media, the social media? Is it money? What do you think is driving that?
Well, I think it's all these different organizations that are, that have come up and all the people that get involved, whether the parents, the best people to volunteer don't have a special needs person. And I always said they're the real champions because they're out there volunteering to be a coach, to pass out water, to just give hugs at the finish line. And one of the big things about Special Olympics and the movement is raising money, right? It's hard for charities to raise money. Well, the law enforcement men and women throughout the world, and especially in the United States, each state law enforcement torch run, they call it, raises millions of dollars for their local state programs. You know, New Jersey, I think they raised $6 or $7 million last year. And you have 50 states doing the same thing. So you're talking about hundreds of millions of dollars. And I think in the last 30 years or 35 years, it's like $750 million they've raised for Special Olympics around the world. It's a huge number. And that raises the profile, raises the visibility, and gives you the ability to talk about the message of Special Olympics and how it impacts families for their athletes. You know, you don't get the chance to do that. No one's given PSAs to every charity out there. So you've got to have people that are willing to do that. And Special Olympics has a lot of people on board now to help, you know, spread the word and talk about the message.
Yeah, it's, you know, it's, there's so much. We just had David Bakelman from the National Pancreas Foundation last week. And there's just so, even just within the cancer world, there's so many options. So you start thinking about, like, you know, where can you do good and where do you want to put your efforts to and money to and resources if you have to choose. So you're fighting for that attention, and
Right. It's
tough out there no matter what you're trying to get attention for.
Well, and all charities are good, but, you know, some of them, they're sad, right? I mean, you know, Make-A-Wish, that's great, but the poor kids dying of cancer, we're sending them to Disney World.
Yeah.
Those, they all need money and they're great charities. The one thing that anyone that's ever gone to a Special Olympics event around any the world or anywhere in New Jersey, any state, it's such a happy, positive thing that you get more out of it as a volunteer, you know, than you give. So, you know, if somebody's out there saying, I really want to volunteer somewhere, get involved with a Special Olympics event and just go there the first time. Every person I met that was a volunteer in my 20 years said, I came for a weekend just to volunteer, and I've been here for 20 years.
Yeah, I've reached out to Joe in for Florida, and I told him I'd love to get involved personally and with Ticket Time Machine in the 22 games. So I plan on being there. I got to figure out how and what we can do, but I'm looking forward to it. You mentioned that they could beat a high school team at basketball, and I don't think it's ever happened, but. Where a special needs, someone who would qualify for the Special Olympics would be participating in the actual Olympics. That's never happened before, correct?
There are Special Olympics athletes that have been in the X Games in snowboarding. I don't know if they've been in the Olympics. I know that one of them was a tremendous athlete and was in the X Games and won a medal.
Yeah.
But the other part of Special Olympics that they created is called Unified Sports, speaking to your question. And so Unified Sports means – you could go to the high school down the street and the men's and the women's varsity basketball teams would team up with the Special Olympics athletes, and you'd have half Special Olympics athletes and half the varsity boys and girls team on both teams, and they would play against each other. And that's become a huge thing in all different sports. In fact, the effect Sean had on his cousins is three of them that live in Virginia started a unified track team at their high school years ago. And then, you know, Tim Tebow does this prom, A Night to Shine. Yeah. They started the one in Richmond, Virginia, which has become huge, where they have all these high school, you know, men and women who volunteer. They shine their shoes. They get dresses for the girls. They get tuxes and suits for the boys. And they just have a great time. And Tim Tebow is one of the best at what he's done for the special needs community. I think there's thousands of these events around the country. And then there's also an organization that Bobby Shriver started, Tim Shriver's brother, one of the Eunice Kennedy Shriver's son, called Best Buddies. And Best Buddies is at these high schools, my three nephews and nieces in Pennsylvania, they just become friends with a special needs person in their high school. And what they told me was they did it because of Sean. And they thought, you know what? Sean taught us that we might be packaged differently, but we're all the same and we all have more in common on the inside. And 10 years later, while they're in college, some of them, and just graduating college, they're still friends with the people they met through Best Buddies. So there's a lot of organizations out there that are doing a lot of good work.
Oh, good to, and you know, this is going to get them some visibility too with you talking about it. Did Sean ever go to the Night to Shine?
No, we didn't make it. We were going to go last year. He was a sponsor of it, though. We sponsored it. It was called Sean Nelligan and his 14 cousins.
Nice.
We sponsored the Shoeshine area.
Yeah, they're doing. I've talked to the Tebow Foundation, trying to get more involved with them, and hopefully I will. But they're doing a lot. Obviously, the Night to Shine and is unbelievable. They're doing some good work with fighting trafficking these days. I think that's their cause now. I'm a Gator, so I'm always going to be a big Tebow fan. Met him a few times. You know, you never know if someone is real. You know, you're an actor, you're a celebrity. He would be the last person that I would expect to find out that he's not who he is. And, there's a lot to be said for that.
Yeah, no, he definitely is. And ironic, you said, who is Sean's favorite person? And I forgot that. He met Tim Tebow. We went down to the Citrus Bowl. We represented them selling sponsorships when Florida was playing somebody. So we have our all-access pass, and we can't figure out how to get in. And we asked the security guard. He goes, just go through that gate, that door there, and you walk right on the field. Okay. Well, we walk in, and it's Florida's locker room. And we're halfway through, like, trying to find the way to the field. And they're all getting dressed, putting their pads on. And all of a sudden, I hear Sean, typical, bellow, "Hey, Tim Tebow, how you doing?" And I'm like, oh, my, here we go again. And he goes, "Hey, buddy, how are you?" He goes, "Come on, Tim, let's win today." He goes, "Okay, we will." And he got his picture with him. So
that's awesome. Yeah, he's doing unbelievable things with a lot of different areas, but certainly special needs is do you know the story of why that even started? Was it just that he wanted to help? Is there a personal side to it? I have to go back and look at it.
I don't know. I don't know.
I'll go back and look at it. A couple of words. We're heading out towards the end here. Wanted to ask you a few questions about your sports background. And we always like to do some rapid fire and talk about some fun stuff. You know, you said you were in the college environment. What do you think would have been different if it's, you know, if you had the NIL going on the way they're doing it now? Are you familiar with what's going on?
Well, trying to pay athletes.
Yeah. So to be able to have that at your, you know, as part of what you're doing.
Well, if you go back in time, what people don't understand about the financial model is 90% of athletic departments lose money. Everybody thinks they all make a ton of money. The big schools make money in football and basketball, and then those profits underwrite however many other varsity sports they have for men and women. So Title IX means you have to give the same number of women's scholarships as you do men's scholarships. Well, therefore, there's no more men's swimming and diving, men's wrestling is dying, men's gymnastics is dying. And you know, even some of the big teams in the Big Ten, they're losing money in total. And it's the financial model doesn't work. If you want to pay, so if you say, "Oh, we'll pay the star football players and the star basketball players," well, then Title IX is going to say, "Well, what about the women's tennis team and the women's crew team?" And the financial model just doesn't work. And if you go to that, you're going to have more of the haves and the have-nots. You're going to have 25 teams that are playing at the top level, and everybody else is going down to the next level.
So, yeah. Yeah, I think it's going to cause a lot of troubles. I'm not against them getting compensated in some way. I just don't think the way they're going to go about it is going to be the most effective, but I guess we'll see. It's one of those things that was always going to happen, and now it is happening.
Yeah, I think the only way you can do it is let them use their likeness. They can get a royalty for their number 10 jersey or their picture or whatever. But otherwise, the financial model just doesn't work.
Yeah, I think I agree with you there. It would be interesting to see. What would you have done if you didn't get into the sports marketing, the college? Did you have something growing up that you were like, "Hey, I think this is what I want to be, lawyer, doctor, astronaut"?
No, I wanted to be a sportscaster.
Okay.
I'd listen to all the sportscasters, and I said, that's what I want to do. And, in fact, that's how, ironically, I got into this sports marketing business was I was working on Wall Street, And I saw on Regis's TV show, this guy, Roy Engelbrecht, who ran the LA Forum back in the day, had a Sportscasters Camps of America at Loyola Marymount College. And you did basketball games for the NBA Summer League, and you do a California Angels baseball game. And your teacher was a guy that was like a low-level college announcer or minor league baseball. And in between the timeouts, we didn't have commercials, he'd had a headset and he'd tell you what you did right, what you did wrong. So they teach a course on the business of it. So I decided, okay, we're going the shortcut. We're not going to go to Little Silver, New Mexico for $200 a game and work our way up and pray we're going to beat Bob Costas. Yeah. And I was on Wall Street making, you know, pretty good money. I'm 30, 29 years old. So I come back and we buy the rights to St. Peter's College for $1,000. And the AD's looking at us like, why would you do this? Oh, that's all right. You only put 10 games on last year. We're going to put all the games on this little station that you had. He goes, okay. He says to his secretary, call up our play-by-play and color guy. I said, oh, no, no, no. I'm your play-by-play announcer and Joe is the color analyst now. He's like, oh, I get it. So basically I did that for 2 years. It was a blast while I was still working on Wall Street. And then I found Jim Host in Lexington, Kentucky, and I end up getting a job offer for Jim to represent the company in New York, where we had the NCAA and Notre Dame and Alabama and Kentucky and everybody. We were the dominant player at the time. And ironically, the last game I did before I had to quit, because I had a real job in sports now, was St. Peter's playing Texas in the first round of the NCAA on a 50,000-watt station, ESPN Radio in New York. That was my last game, so I retired on top.
That's great.
And then, ironically, I owned the company. I had 300 sportscasters that worked for me between football, basketball, baseball at 45, 50 schools.
There's your boy, Craig Nyer.
That's my buddy, Craig. Hello, Craig.
Hey, Craig. You ever see The Boom Goes the Dynamite guy? That's what I think of that with broadcasting. Have you seen that clip, Boom Goes the Dynamite? It's one of the most awkward, it's just really tough to watch. I'll have to send you the link to it, but I don't know if Brent is still listening. We watched that. It's funny and sad. And anyway, it was,
send that to me. Love to see it.
It's crazy. Do you have a favorite movie?
What's my favorite movie? Live Like Sean, the new one coming out in 2 years.
Do you have a favorite sports movie? Let's just say, how about favorite sports movie?
Favorite sports movie, probably Rudy.
Rudy, yeah, great. I love that scene when he's talking to the guy and he tells him he's quitting. That's just that's a life lesson scene right there. What was your favorite event that you ever went to with Sean?
The Super Bowl, when he was the only person in the stadium that thought the Giants were going to beat Tom Brady and the undefeated Patriots by far. When I get sad, I always change my mindset because I read a book that said the human mind cannot have a negative and a positive thought at the same time. Right. So when the bad stuff comes in the head, I just think of him in the stands at that game when the game ended, the big smile. He was happier than the Giants players.
Was that his favorite game, do you think?
That was his favorite game, but his favorite game was the one he was at.
Yeah.
They were all great. Every game he went to, he said, that was a great game.
That's your team loses.
I mean, he went to a bunch of Super Bowls. He went to a bunch of Final Fours, tons of Big East and other events.
So you've obviously been to a ton. Is there a bucket list event that you haven't been to yet that you'd love to get to?
Well, I've been to almost everything. I want to play golf at Augusta. That's my bucket list.
Okay.
So any members of Augusta on here, give me a buzz.
We might know some people. One person, I'd love to hear it for you and for Sean, and this will be the last question. One person, 24 hours you get to spend with them to do whatever you want. They have to be living. It can't be a family member. Who are you picking, and what are you guys doing?
Oh, that's a tough
one. What you would have said and what you would say.
That's a tough question, but I think it would be either Derek Jeter, Tim Tebow, or Eli Manning. All three, in a foursome.
And for you?
Drive along in the car.
Is that for you or for Sean?
That's for Sean.
Yeah, how about for you?
Who would I want to spend the day with? Can't be a family member. Sean. I would like to spend the day with Sean.
You've got to be living. I'd love to spend the day with Sean.
The Pope.
The Pope? Okay.
I don't know how you get to him.
I don't know how we would. Well, listen, I really appreciate you coming on. You know, I'm excited to read the book. I know you got a lot of offers, so for you to take some time to talk to me and my audience is it really means a lot to me. I'm here to help you any way I can. We got Live Like Sean and the hashtag, the TJNelligan.com. Is that the best place to buy the book?
Yeah, we have TJNelligan.com, which also has all the stories about Sean. So if you want to learn more about Sean's story, go to TJNelligan.com, TJ Nelligan Facebook, LinkedIn, Instagram, and Twitter. And you can buy it on Amazon, Barnes & Noble, or anywhere books are sold.
Great. Well, I look forward to reading it. I hope some people that tuned in today or when we share this, and they'll get to read it and share Sean's stories, keep the memory going, get that hashtag Live Like Sean trending. And again, really appreciate it. We got Todd Radom, author of Fabric of the Game, coming up Friday. So I appreciate everyone tuning in. Thanks again, TJ. We look forward to talking to you again. And that's it. Everyone have a great Wednesday. We'll talk to you soon. Live like Sean.
Thank you.